midway through the course, chemical and engineering thermodynamics. So it's like right after their midterm. So before the midterm, they also focus on engineering thermodynamics. After the midterm, it's like a whole new course. They do chemical thermodynamics. So it's like, I guess at this lecture, I've already finished motivating them about the need to study mixture thermodynamics, because this is most of the material they'll be seeing in today's class. They're going to be seeing it for the rest of the course, and also for courses in their junior year, two more courses, separations and reactions engineering. So I think the motivation part is pretty much over by the time we start this lecture. And in this lecture, I'm just going to do, you know, introduce some definition, do some workload problems. And the handouts are in sort of fill in the blank format. If you want to take notes, you can. If you don't want to take notes and just listen, that's also cool. So.
Alright, go ahead.
Alright, let's get started. We're going to begin with the problem. You have 1 mole of ethanol and 1 mole of water, and you have the molar volumes for each of these. Your task is to find out what the total volume would be when you mix up these two components in 50-50 ratio at this particular temperature and atmospheric pressure. So how many of you, just looking at this problem, feel like this is super easy, trivial? Can you raise your hands?
Would it be aligned going on the other side.
Yeah, you're right. So it would exactly be like this. Again, it's an example of a non-ideal mixture, but this time it has a positive deviation from the ideal behavior. So let's actually go on to some math. Now all this stuff about liking each other and disliking each other sounds very woozy and weird to many of you. Let's quantify this weirdness. So one way to quantify this weird behavior of real mixtures is a term that I'm going to introduce, partial molar properties. And this is a definition I'm going to take you through in this slide. So let theta underscore be a molar mixture property. This could be anything. This could be volume, this could be enthalpy, internal energy or entropy. Now we are going to define a new term, theta overscore subscript I. Now I wanted to be really mindful whenever using an underscore and an overscore. Things are now going to be the same after this class because you're going to keep getting mixed up. In fact, in the handouts, I corrected many things by hand because I got it mixed up, so this is confusing. So just keep in mind that the overscore is only used for the partial molar property. Now, when you go ahead and define it, this is nothing but a partial derivative evaluated at constant temperature, pressure, and keeping the number of moles of the other guys constant. I'll take you through the water ethanol mixture so you can understand the definition a little better. But having this definition basically allows us to compute the mixture volumes in terms of the partial molar properties instead of using the pure substance properties. This is the key difference between what we did in the beginning of the class and what we're going to do right now. So you're not going to be using the pure substance properties here, you're going to be using the partial molar properties. And partial molar properties, some of you the math may not be intuitive. So one metaphor that we can use is personality. For example, when I am living alone and I am in solitude, that would be my pure substance property. I'm a certain way when I'm all by myself. But when I'm teaching in a classroom, I'm kind of different, right? I behave differently. And if I'm at home with my family, again, I'm different. So I guess molecules are also like people. They have personalities that are sensitive to their environment, to their physical and chemical environment. So they're sensitive to temperature, pressure, and also, you know, whether they're in a mixture or not, and what kind of mixture it is. So it's one way to understand partial molar properties. Now, we are going back to the ethanol-water mixture. We are going to be defining the partial molar volume for water. You'll notice that this partial derivative is evaluated with respect to the number of moles of water while keeping the temperature and pressure constant, but also the number of moles of ethanol constant. The expression for ethanol looks very similar. Again, you're evaluating this partial derivative with respect to ethanol moles while keeping the temperature, pressure, and number of moles of water constant. Now, it seems to be easy to calculate the volume from the partial molar volumes, but how the hell do we get the partial molar volumes? So this is kind of like the chicken and egg problem. If you have the mixture volumes, you can compute the partial molar volumes. If you have the partial molar volumes, you can compute the mixture volumes. You need to know one or the other. In this case, you're going to sort of go and look at all these experimental data sets to pull out the partial molar volumes. A lot of people have collected all this data. So right now for this problem, we can just get the partial molar volumes by interpolating this graph. So we have a 50-50 mixture here. So I look at this graph for partial molar volume of water, and then I get this value 16.9 ml per mole for the partial molar volume of water. And the same way, at the same composition for ethanol, it's 57.4. So in the past, we had used the pure substance molar volume for ethanol in water. Now we are going to be using the partial molar volumes for ethanol in water. This is the right way to do it. Here we are using 16.9 and 57.4 instead of 18 and 58. So again, we go back and revisit this expression where we are again replacing the pure substance properties with the partial molar properties. And we are getting an answer which is slightly more realistic. The old answer we got was 76 mils. The new answer we got is 74.3, which is 1.7 mils lower. This is the shrinkage that I'm talking about, that is a result of this strong water ethanol intermolecular binding. And if there's anything you want to remember from this lecture, don't use weighted averages, or at least not all the time. That's the takeaway for this lecture. Real mixtures can't be described by weighted averages. You have to use partial molar properties. So I'm going to end with a small clicker evaluation. Since you don't have clickers, I guess you can use a show of hands. So how many people think A is true? Anyone for B? C? I see some people are undecided, but does anyone want to talk about why they think C is correct?
Is it how you're talking about when people are in different situations?
Yeah, so that's correct, but can someone sort of extend what Colleen just said?
Also, it's an ideal and a real situation.
Yeah, exactly. It depends on whether it's ideal or real. So for an ideal thing, this would be true. For a real thing, this is true. So it really depends on whether you're talking about an ideal mixture or a real mixture. So any questions about anything we learned today?
I'm still confused about the upper bar, under bar.
That's a great question. So the way I like to talk about it is through a table. So you're either talking about a mixture or a combination.
So you have to stay after class and she'll talk to you about that then. Thank you.